Hello and welcome to DevTalks. This is Adi Achin, proud to present to you a latest series of crisp and clear strategic discussions called the General's Talk. Featuring Lieutenant General Ravi Shankar and Lieutenant General Satish Dua. Lieutenant General Ravi Shankar, PVSM, AVSM, BSM, a retired Director General of the Artillery. He has deep knowledge and understanding as well as experience in successful defense planning and acquisition. Now a professor in the Aerospace Department of the IIT Chennai. He is also an author of a strategic blog called thegunnershot.com. Lieutenant General Satish Dua, PVSM, UYSM, SM, BSM, served as the Chief of the Integrated Defence Staff to the Chairman of the Chiefs of Staff Committee. He was also the Commander of the 15th Corps looking after the LOC against Pakistan. Today, he is a strategic thinker as well as an author of a book called the India's Bravehearts. Subscribe to Dev Talks and hear what the generals have to say. Jai Hind. Thank you both for joining us today. And we will be discussing the India's COVID situation along with the geopolitics that surrounds it.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for inviting us over to this meeting, Adi.
Yeah, good to be here again, Adi, talking to you and to General Shankar. And this is a very relevant topic, and everybody, the whole world is caught up with this. So it's good to discuss this in whichever dimension that we choose to.
Agree with you, sir. General Shankar, I'd like to start with you with the first question, which talks about COVID situation. You know, it's pretty bad in India today, and it's going to have a lasting impact on the geopolitics that India has tried to build or is considering to build in and around the world. I'd like you to take the focus on China and tell us how this COVID crisis is going to affect our relations with China, as well as what is the impact on the dependence on China.
Right. First and foremost, as far as the COVID situation in India is concerned, at this point of time, it's on a sort of a level field. We don't know which way it will go. But indications are that things are coming under control, though you'll have spurts up and down. Much of the geopolitics which will evolve will depend on how the situation goes from here, right? If we are able to pull out of this, we will be internally strong and, you know, everything will restitute. But if this thing goes prolonged, it'll affect our economy, and hence it might affect our geopolitics in the short run. In the long run, I don't see any difference, because India has the capability of restituting, and India is a large nation with a large population. So that is the first thing which we need to understand. So there's no need for any despondency or saying that, look, India is going to go down. It can't. Right. Also look at it. Our military strength is completely intact. Okay. There's no problem. It's only the economy which will probably take a hiccup a bit. Right. So with that hiccup in the economy, you might have a little hiccup of your diplomatic effort. So it's your diplomatic power and your economic power which is affected, not your military power. So your geopolitics don't change. Your Quad doesn't change. Many things don't change. So having said that, how do we handle China? Look, China will perceive that India is geopolitically weak. They're portraying it up as such. Photograph which showed a rocket taking off and a pyre burning side by side, which was put out by the Chinese Communist Party. It is indicative of something very great. Deep. I won't say great, deep. They're conscious of the fact that they're going to put you down, and deliberately. We should also be conscious of the same thing. One. Number two, there is no doubt that China is going to be our long-term adversary, and there's no friendship left anymore. Right. The third thing is that, they blocked all our supplies. Now they've said they will give supplies. We don't know whether they're going to come or not. Right. And these supplies are not direct purchases. Some might be direct purchases. Some are third party purchases through others who said we'll give it to you. So there's a little hassle going on. The fourth thing about this whole story is that, you know, we've kept them out of the 5G trials. Right. So take all this. We're going to have enhanced competition. China will drive it home that India is the weakest partner of the Quad. In fact, it is no partner of the Quad. That's the way they will put it on. They will also show that, look, all countries have enforced travel bans on India, right? Australia, USA, all the partners of this thing. So where is it? But one, we don't have to look at it that way. If we have a problem, why should we transfer our problem to others? So we, all the travel bans have to be understood in those lines, right? So I don't think we should be worried about that. But China, I think we're in for a you know, period where they think they have the cards. And we, if we pull out fast, we can say, thank you, you don't have all the cards, and it will come back. In the long run, we will pull out, our economy will recover. You can't stop 1.3 billion people from recovering. Also, sooner or later, I would say sooner, we will recover. Look, you have to remember, we have done about 15, 16 crores of vaccination. In a couple of months, it will double or triple. Right? That's the expectation and the probably the planning. That's what the sense I get out of people talking. So I am sanguine that in a couple of months, if this, when this event is passed, you'll say, look, it's gone. You'll, something else will open up. We'll go to a different place. And then we'll be able to take on China squarely. And we must. Right? This is my view. Satish, if you have any other view or anything to add, please go ahead.
Absolutely. I agree with you. The overall you know, analysis that you made. China is trying to play up the some of the issues that we are going through on our domestic front. And it is their stated policy. I mean, we all read and talk about their informationized warfare, or the three warfares that they're indulging in, information warfare. So when you mentioned about that particular post, it's not only that, it's also about anything. It's today perception is more important than reality. And I absolutely agree that we will pull out of it. But also to, you know, add on to what you said, India is the only country that stood up to China, whether it was Ladakh during this happened, and of course 3 years ago at Dolom. We are the only country, even the USA has not done it. We have banned their apps. I lose count because we did it in about 4 or 5 different tranches. So hundreds of apps have been banned. Chinese apps have been banned. We have put them out of 5G. We had put them out of some other infrastructure construction tenders earlier. So India is, and we are the ones who openly go against their and stalk against their BRI initiative. So my point is, India has been standing up to China, whatever is our situation right now. So that's as far as the COVID thing is concerned. And I agree with you. We will pull out. We are having some issues right now, but India will pull out. We have very strong fundamentals.
No, you put all these things together, expect more trouble from China. We should be prepared for it, right? Okay, and they'll take no, they will, you know, waste no opportunity to put us down. Okay, that's the nature of the world politics and geopolitics, but there's nothing to be worried about. Yeah,
I agree with you. So they won't lose an opportunity to put us down, and that is something that we've been seeing. And General Dua, also, you also mentioned about the info warfare. That is something that, again, we can see around the place. General Dua, sir, I'd like to indulge you in a similar line of thought with regards to Pakistan. Although we are not dependent on Pakistan as per se for anything except for peace and tranquility within the region, how do you see the India-Pakistan relations, whatever they are, shaping up with looking at this COVID situation in India, as well as what is happening in Pakistan itself, sir?
So even before this, the COVID crisis hit the world, the relations between India and Pakistan were at the lowest ever. I mean, in terms of diplomatic relations, we don't have good relations. We were at loggerheads as far as our stand of no terror and talks together. And as far as Pakistan is concerned, they would say, roll back 370 and only then we will talk. Be that as it may, the both the armies at the LOC have been facing each other. Violence at the LOC has been the way it was earlier. It's nothing new. So also the violence in the hinterland of Kashmir. Now, in the recent few months, during this corona situation, let's also not forget that during the last year and now counting, there is also this development that Pakistan has had to contend with, in addition to what's happening with India. One, it is on their Western Front, with the US troops pulling out of Afghanistan, and their involvement with the Afghanistan government and with the Taliban and the other attendant details. So Pakistan is fully embroiled in that respect as well. Domestically, we know that Pakistan's economy is taken a big hit. Every month they have to borrow to pay their debt servicing. So Pakistan's economy is in doldrums. It does require support from the West, and every time that it comes up, we know that how we talk about the FATF list, whether they'll be in grey list or black, etc. Politically also, at the present moment, the developments in the last month or two, the political situation in Pakistan is not very stable, with the TLP now sort of creating violence and all that, in addition to whatever the COVID situation is forcing on the population of Pakistan. With all this happening, I do not really foresee that Pakistan and India will, put it this way, that Pakistan will try and create any spectacular actions against India, whether it's on the LOC or in the hinterland. Pakistan, India has taken very strong steps earlier. India has made it very clear to Pakistan as to what our reactions will be. We have seen in the last month or a little over 2 months, initially that was a heartening step that both the armies, both the militaries actually recommitted to an existing ceasefire agreement. And since then, the ceasefire agreement on the LOC has held. Now, why it was done? It is very clear that Pakistan was suffering great losses in men and material, and that is the reason why they recommitted to it. On the other hand, it was a statement in itself that a joint statement was issued. In absence of any political and diplomatic interactions between the two countries at any significant level. So it was a good thing that we had a joint statement issue. The last thing I'd like to say, there is this issue of trade that started off a month ago, where Pakistan said that they would, initially there was a statement coming out that we will go ahead and buy sugar and cotton and yarn from India. But eventually, because of some political, domestic and other pressures, their own interplay, they stopped short or they cancelled their announcement. I don't foresee major problem with Pakistan at the moment, with the day-to-day functioning at the LOC, and the violence levels will continue. But the last sentence I'd like to say, the test will come now, because now is the time. At every year in Kashmir, in J&K, this is the time when passes will open, when the snow will melt, and traditionally, infiltration attempts and attempts to rejuvenate violence activities now pick up in summers. So it remains to be seen as to how it goes on now. But as of now, we are firmly in control as far as this dynamic with Pakistan is concerned.
Mm.
Would you, Shankar sir, add something? You see, look at it. I'll sum it up what General Dua has said. There's internal instability in Pakistan due to economics, politics, and TLP, right? On the Western thing, there's a external instability looming up in Afghanistan with the drawdown and Afghanistan peace process going nowhere. On the Eastern flank, with India, India itself is in a bit of an unstable kind of a situation when you look at it from the Pakistani point of view. Pakistan overall is in a state of extreme flux and instability. Now, we are having a misstep at this point of time. So, in this kind of a time, it's best we leave Pakistan alone. Let them stew in their own juices. Right? And keep a watch on the LOC, like then Dua said, this is the time for opening of the passes. Keep track. Stop that. Focus on that. And I don't think there's any time to do any peace initiative or anything with Pakistan. And neither is Pakistan capable of doing anything against us at this point of time. Yeah, I think that sums up the Pakistan angle and the geopolitics around.
Pretty much, yes. One thing I think all of us, the viewers, would want to understand is that the COVID situation in India is not just India. It's going to affect everyone around and across the world as well. So, yeah. Looking at that, General Shankar, I'd like you to take a view at our neighborhood with regards Bangladesh, with regards Nepal, with regards Bhutan, with regards Myanmar, the coup which is happening there, Sri Lanka, who's going into a lockdown as well. Nepal, as I mentioned again, I'd like to mention, is in a lockdown. How do you think the situation around India is going to be, sir?
See, first and foremost, whatever the COVID situation in India will have a spillover effect into all our neighbors. I mean, the way people move across all these borders, especially with Bhutan and Nepal, right? And to a certain extent, even in Bangladesh, right? And Myanmar also. But luckily, that side in Myanmar, it's not that much. So, the COVID situation spillover will be there. And all these countries don't have that kind of capacity, to handle it on their own. So, it will be prudent on our part, notwithstanding whatever is happening. Like I said, the fundamental is that maybe in a month or so, we'll be looking at a different dynamic altogether. So, we need to also take them into account to help them and reach out to them. And, wherever their capacity falls short, we need to help them out. That's one part. The second thing is, this is the time when China, I'm talking of China specific, will make ingress. They're already attempting at Sri Lanka. The defense minister went there. They will attempt something in Bangladesh. So, we need to somehow block that. We need to be aware of the fact that we need to counter that. If we can't counter that immediately, we need to have a plan to neutralize it in the long run. Right. As far as Myanmar is concerned, Myanmar is still in a cauldron. We don't know which way the coin will fall. Right. And neither are the Chinese too interested in getting into it at this point of time, nor are we interested in getting into it at this point of time. So, it's a wait and watch policy. Right? That's how it is. Right. And one more thing, the neighbors also know that eventually they have to come back to India for many things, or immediate neighbors, right? And you just look at not only these neighbors, look at the slightly extended neighborhood, look at Maldives, Afghanistan, Seychelles and all these. We need to continue to help them. Look, notwithstanding what's happening in India, I keep reiterating, and this is what I'm writing about. Delhi is in a mess, not the rest of India. No doubt. And Delhi also is showing signs of, recovery. So, it's a matter of time. We need to be confident in the fact that India has tremendous strength to come out of it. And once we come out of it, even the neighbors will be that much more benefited, right? And our vaccine production capacity has gone nowhere. It's still intact. It's only that there's a bit of a issue because of the change in policy. It will happen, right? I'm quite sanguine things will go well. Your views, Satish?
No, see, with all these countries in the neighborhood, we've always, from the very beginning, we've been extending a helping hand. I mean, the vaccine Maitri. And like you said, we must continue to do that. Because this, we keep getting back to it, but this is a temporary phase. What's happening in Delhi and around. India is a big country with a lot of depth and resilience. And we need to help other countries, and other countries in the neighborhood do realize that too.
That is interesting. It's not I think that is one factor which is missing in all the discussions about COVID, that this is a temporary phase. it's not going to go on forever. It's something which has been portrayed across, probably with regards to the information war as per se, as something that India is going to, you know, go on with or carry on its back forever and ever.
I would like to reinforce this point, you know, which we not need to understand to everyone who's seen. You look at Kerala, you look at Maharashtra, you look at Orissa, you look at Tamil Nadu, right? They're all recovering.
Mm.
Even Rajasthan is recovering. What's so great? They'll recover. Look, COVID will not run away. It's not run away from the rest of the world either. Okay, they're not done something very great.
Mm.
We are in a muddle of Delhi. We understand it. I'm sure things will come out. Right? Already the deaths in Delhi are coming down, which is a good thing. The overall cases are coming down. Right? So, it'll stabilize. We just have to have faith in ourselves.
Mm.
And move ahead. That's it. Yeah.
Correct, sir. And as a matter of fact, what happened in the US has not been forgotten by... It might have been forgotten by the commentators, but it's not been forgotten by people who actually watched the situation. Jaldwa, taking the US forward, sir, I'd like to ask you, you know, there's been a... I wouldn't call it a full stop, but I'll call it a comma in the relations between India and USA with the stopping or the restrictions which were put across on the raw materials. It's a funny news that came out yesterday that they could not send 2 aircraft to India with some aid because the aircraft were under maintenance issues. It may be so, may not be so, but in the larger picture, when you look at something like this coming across, it does seem a little weird. How do you think the India-USA relations is going to open out during and post this COVID crisis?
Look, my view is that firstly, at a larger level, just rising above the COVID situation also, India and USA, in my view, are two natural allies in the opposite ends of the world. We are natural allies because, I mean, the oldest democracy and the largest democracy, our values are very, very, very similar. We don't pose a threat to each other in any which way. Also, that our we don't have any interest with each other's enemy or adversary, shall I say. So, my point is that we are natural allies. We have always been on the same side of any strategic equation, at least in the recent past. However, India does exercise its own strategic autonomy. As we are seeing in the recent past, whether it is to, I won't say contain, but whether it is to balance China, whether it is for Afghanistan issues or the rest of it in the Indo-Pacific, the US is leaning more and more on India. In fact, the US wants India to participate more. And India and US are getting strategically closer. We are having many linkages and many arrangements with each other. Without expanding the discussion, whether it is Quad or whether it is our own international, our own bilateral defense relations in terms of defense industry and supplying of equipment, our issues with CATSA and other things and the other agreements that have been signed between India and US. So we are cooperating a lot. To your question about this, the COVID situation and the recent rankling of or the feathers being ruffled because of a certain logistic issues between us, more so when India says that India was very forthcoming in supplying the chloroquine or when it was required, India reached out. I think that even this particular issue will get ironed out. It is something that has created some issues, but I think it is being worked at. People are working at it, and we should not straight away jump to conclusions. Such like things will also happen, and I'm sure we'll be able to, I won't say take it in our stride, but we will be able to paper over them and take the necessary corrective steps. I feel it is all the more reason now that in various aspects, we are talking about, the world is talking about China's way of doing things, whether it is informationized warfare or, with other countries, whether it is to do with how they are behaving when other countries are down because of the corona crisis, how we need to be together in the Indo-Pacific to shall I say, monitor the Chinese activities when they are adversarial in nature. Our Quad, in which India and US are two very prominent partners, our Quad is now engaging with a little renewed enthusiasm. When all this is happening, I think India and US need to sort out whatever issues that have occurred, and eventually I think the two countries really need to strengthen the relations we have, strengthen the ties we have, and the strong understanding that we have of each other. General Shankar, you'd like to say something?
Yeah, let me put it in two, three points in perspective. First, India and America are both democracies, and democracies will have their hiccups. These are all functional hiccups, right? So I'm not too bothered about them at all. The second thing which is of importance is, it's India and America who can alone handle China in this world. There's no third country which can handle China militarily. Right? We have the experience, they have the heft. Right? And put together both these, we'll completely outmatch China militarily. And everyone knows this. Even China knows this. That's why it takes a little time to, this thing. And like I said, we've been all talking this thing. This relationship is far too deep, nurtured over 20 years, it'll falter over the next 1 or 2 months. And we also have to remember, last point which I'd like to put across about China, in USA and India, is both of us are going through a transition. USA is going through a transition on its own. It has its problem during its elections and all that. And there's a transition going there. And we are also having a transition. Our transition is a double transition. One is our change from a normal regional player into probably a big part. One, again, I'm not looking at it for the 1 month, 2 months. Look at it long. And the second transition is, how do you transit from the current COVID state to the post-COVID state? So we're going through our own transition. So things in transition will have friction. Wheels in motion will have friction. So let's accept it at that point of and leave it at that.
Interesting, sir. I think instead of looking at a shorter pessimist sort of a picture, you're looking at a larger picture. Sir, before I close this discussion, I'd like both of you to spend just a little time to tell us the impact on India's soft power as part of a good closing to this very, very interesting discussion, sir. General Shankar, would you like to begin, sir?
See, again, look at it in the long term. We are going through a problem, we'll resolve it. There's no problem. Once you get out, your soft power is there. The soft power has not run away anywhere. Okay? Did America's soft power reduce just because it went through a lot of problems last year? Okay? Has China's soft power increased because the way it has behaved? Nothing. Zero. Right? Soft power is soft and very malleable. It'll reaffirm itself very fast. And then people will forget what has happened. Okay? And geopolitics is a long-term affair. You have to look over it in the long-term thing and not through the short-term lens of 1, 2, 3 months or probably even 1 year. Probably even 2 years. I will put it even 10 years. Geopolitics between India and China, we'll have to look at it in the long run. Because they do it in the long run, we should also do it in the long run.
Interesting. Yeah. Jalduwa,
sir? Let me just put a couple of sentences forth and say, soft power by its definition means it is not really a hard power of a missile or using some grants, etc. Soft power by its own concept means you are talking of other things. You are talking of how we can influence and shape things. And to that extent, I think it's really not going to get dented. In fact, if anything, the moment you overcome any crisis, because India is going through a larger magnitude than the average of the countries at the moment, So you come out actually stronger. Then you come out and you are able to actually draw better lessons and come out stronger. So our soft power will remain as effective as it was, if not more.
In fact, it might increase.
Yes.
Yeah, because, you know, see, remember what the WHO official had said. It was India who led the world out of polio and smallpox. For all you know, this catastrophe which we are facing will help the world get out of the COVID.
And so also the first wave.
Yeah.
The first wave, India was, everyone was following what India
so, look, we are in a crisis. We understand the problem. We are in a problem. Fine. But we'll get out of it. And when we get out of it, we'll be the leaders in getting out of it. So let's have that confidence in ourselves.
I agree, sir. Thank you so much for this lovely discussion, sir. I think it is much required to hear positive, you know, affirmations about what is happening around us. And India is not sunk as what a lot of people might want to portray to us. So I'd like to thank both of you for joining me this on this day in the middle of the COVID crisis in India and sharing your thoughts.
Thanks a lot. It was a great discussion.
Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Jai Hind.